blessing to be with you on this day, even in the cold. I'm not used to 5 or 10 degrees below zero. It's really a new test upon my cultural adjustment. But we've come through a good Christmas season, a new start here for the new year. This month I'd like to preach on and delve into some passages about new life and new beginnings that will give us some strength for the new year as we discover new ways to reach out, as we come together as the body of Christ here at First Baptist, being encouraged and empowered. I want to begin with those passage of 2 Corinthians in mind, if you hold it there in front of you. But if you could picture with me in your mind, down in Cape Canaveral in Florida, there's a big rocket, you know, and it's going to have a liftoff, and it's going to go up into space and circle the Earth and maybe even go out to the moon and come back. And so at liftoff, there's an incredible blast. In fact, people are not allowed to be very, very close because it shakes the Earth and it's dangerous. They often stand a mile or 2 miles away and see this light. The fuel in the rocket is such that when it's ignited, there are thousands of pounds of force. Even in the area of, they say, 250,000 foot-pounds of thrust, it takes this rocket and lifts it up into the atmosphere. That is amazing to me. And so when this rocket goes off, the Earth shakes, and the amount of power that is needed to escape the Earth's atmosphere is huge. And it's calculated by a lot of smart people. Now, just in parentheses, along that line, when the month of February is Black History Month, and we have some African-American read-ins, I wanted to recommend to you that movie, Hidden Figures. It's about women who are mathematicians who calculated all the necessary measurements for the re-entry of the rocket back into the Earth's atmosphere. They're very smart ladies, brilliant, and they're African-American women, and they had to also go against the tide of the culture at that day. And that's a good movie to watch in honor of them. And so the rocket going off, I say, is like the blast of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. God did not just revive Jesus from the grave, he totally transformed him. He was the first to rise from the dead. I think it's like a rocket blast off. That's what Jesus, God did through to Jesus, gave him that victory. It wasn't like going to the emergency room where the doctors revive you with oxygen and different types of drugs and pump on your chest and all that kind of stuff. No, this was a total, complete transformation. Remember John 11, the story of Lazarus. Lazarus has died. He was in the tomb, and Jesus waited 4 days before he was get there. And Mary and Martha said, they were weeping, saying, Jesus, if only you'd been here, you would never die. But Jesus cried out to him. He said, take the stone away. And Lazarus, come out. And Lazarus came out. They unwrapped the cloth. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. And so that is incredible. That's an incredible parable, an incredible happening, which tells us, however, Lazarus, later he died. The resurrection of Christ is different. He was totally transformed. And yes, someday God will unleash a power so great that all people will be raised up and the Earth will be transformed. That's incredible, I say, like rocket power. And today, as God's people, when we read 2 Corinthians 5:17, this new year, that verse, the key verse, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, The new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. New year, new life, new creation. How does it happen? The reason I began with the rocket illustration is because the full context of that 2 Corinthians and 1 Corinthians and Paul writing a letter is that, remember, in 1 Corinthians, he takes a whole chapter, the 15th chapter, in which he defends the resurrection. He's saying it is real. It's a real thing. It's a tremendous blast off. In fact, if you don't have the resurrection, you really don't have Christian faith. But no one thought that the Jewish Messiah would be crucified on a Roman cross and be raised from the dead. It's a wonder. But Paul is saying, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. That's the theme verse. The next statement of the big picture here in 2 Corinthians, the reason for this letter is kind of a defense against what others are accusing you of. There in 2 Corinthians 11:13, there are false apostles, deceitful workers, masquerading as Christ's apostles, have come up against Paul and opposed him and given him a hard time. And Paul is really dealing with this opposition later in the letter. But this is the total context in which he now is making a defense. He is really defending himself and saying, look, I am really a true representative of Christ. I'm a true apostle. I'm not a fake person going around. I don't have a false agenda. The opponents of Paul treated him as an imposter or a fake. So Paul had a battle. He really had a battle going on. And so Paul is defending himself a lot by the whole context. And he says, you're a new creature in Christ. Then he says, he talks about being an ambassador. And he talks about reconciliation. He's really telling us in all of these things, he wants to show that he's the real deal. He has the real message. He knows the gospel. And those who oppose him are not. See, he is really doing battle. And if you read some of those passages in 2 Corinthians, he's been beaten 39 times. He endured much suffering. He was rejected. He is someone who is not doing this out of his own gain, but for his love for God. So I have a 3-point sermon for today. 1, being a new creature in Christ. 2, being reconciled to God. 3, being you're an ambassador for Christ. It's in that text, right there in your bulletin. So, have you become a new creature in Christ? Perhaps a clarifying verse is Galatians 6:15. Listen to this. Neither circumcision nor uncircumcision means anything. What counts is a new creation. Now, you know, we all know I can make some jokes about circumcision or uncircumcision. But it was the badge, put a little badge here, you know, for identification of the Jews against all the other pagan nations that they were different. That's what God instructed for the Jews to do. And Paul was saying that the only thing really that matters is new creation. We know that that was an institution in the Old Testament as a badge of differentiation, you know, that big word for the Jewish people against the surrounding nations. But Paul was saying, it doesn't really matter, circumcision or uncircumcision. In the New Testament, as Paul went forward, he told about how then this new creation in Jews and Gentiles responding, they wanted to be new creatures in Christ. You know, there was a big meeting among the Christians in Acts 15 when Gentiles and Jews were becoming Christian, and the Jews said, well, they have to go obey all those laws in the Old Testament. And after that big meeting, they said, no, they really don't. the only faith is enough. Faith is enough. What matters is the new creation. Psalm 51, part of our worship reading, David cries out to God there after he made a big mistake. He committed adultery. He saw that lady far there on the rooftop. He was tempted beyond what he could sustain. He got together with her, made a baby, and after the baby was born, it begins to die. He is so heartbroken. He is taken down. He cries out, "Create in me a clean heart, oh God." David was devastated. Only God can do this new thing. Only the Holy Spirit working inside of us. In fact, from the day you accepted Christ, then he has begun to make you a new creature in him. We can make improvements. We can repair. We can adjust. You can tweak. And how about when you're turning off your computer and it says, don't turn off your computer till all these updates are installed. You can do that. You can put a patch. You can turn over a new leaf. But only God can do a creative thing in your heart. He's doing it as soon as you open your heart and say to him, like that scripture there, "I am powerless." He wants to rush in. He loves to hear us say that, "Oh Lord, just help me come and make my heart clean." The same rocket power that raised Jesus from the dead is at work in your heart, your life today. If anyone is in Christ, there's a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. It's a miracle. You know what? After meditating on this, what God really wants is you. He wants you. Preparation here, anyone in Christ, refers to that union that you are experiencing with him. As we believe in him, he begins to mold us and to make us into a new creature in which new desires are there in our life. New desires to please him. New desires to be with people who love God. New desires to sing and to praise. A desire to pray. A desire to learn the Bible. This has all come from being part of Christ in your life. My first point, 3 points sermon for the new year, being a new creature in Christ. Next is being reconciled to God. The text says, through Christ, who gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ and not counting men's sins against them. As young people would say, that's awesome. I hear them say that. I'm not old, but I hear them say that. Hey, man, that's awesome. So, in a sense, while Christ is dying on the cross, God is not counting our sins against us. God is reconciling the world. The next step, though, is that we have to accept him by faith. And so in the Lord's Supper today, that's what we're remembering. We're remembering Jesus, his body is dying there, his blood that was shed. On the cross, he was reconciling, bringing together that which was far away. So if God was reconciling us, reconciling humanity to himself through the cross, then it must have been that there was a great separation or a great alienation or hostility where people were at enmity with Christ. And that needed to be brought together. The separation, it's classic Isaiah 59:1, where he said, the prophet there saying to the people of Israel, "Your sins have caused a great separation between you and the Lord." It's a relationship break. But God was the one who was taking the initiative through Jesus to bring things together, to heal this relationship. He makes the initiative that is. Young people would say, that's awesome. That's amazing. For many of you here, we have a lot of wisdom here, know that long-term friendships between people, you may have known friends or had relationships for a long time. Many of these mistakes, whatever, have been made in relationships or friendships. If you would keep a record of the wrongs, the friendship probably wouldn't come to an end. But that's what God is saying and modeling through Jesus, is that he's not remembering the wrongs. He's not counting the wrongs, but bringing reconciliation between God and humankind. That is hope for us. It's motivated by the love of God, God's love, that he would bring this repair. So we probably have here broken relationships and memories of broken relationships and things that have been done. Well, Jesus forgiving us through his death on the cross away. We need to accept that and come to him and believe in him. Finally, we are called to be ambassadors of this reconciliation. Just as the United States sends ambassadors to other countries, we have embassies around the world, and those ambassadors represent the U.S. to other countries. It's a big deal. And as being present, serving, and being in another country, people are proud to go to the U.S. embassy when you have a problem. And in some places around the world, you get there and you find out that if you have a mistake or an accident, or you misuse what you think is a blessing here, free speech, you'll find out that you have to go to the embassy and get help from your ambassador. And then you're glad for this ambassador from the U.S. who can help you out. If you lose your passport, you're sunk. You're not going to go anywhere. You need help from the ambassador. You need the people who represent this country to come. In a sense, you are an ambassador of Christ. God is making his appeal through you. He is using your actions, kindness, your love, your smile to say to the world, he's appealing to others that reconciliation is possible. His offer is coming through you. Imagine that. God is saying, I want you to be my ambassador. I'm signing you up. And by your very witness, your smile, your actions, your words, you're going to help bring reconciliation between people. And young people would say, oh, that's awesome. An ambassador for Christ. There may have been a time when you were not interested in that, but now the Holy Spirit has been working in your life and you're saying, I really feel good that I'm proud to be an ambassador. This ambassador, from the Christian perspective now, helps to break down these walls and these barriers between others. You know, these problems. And so here at First Baptist, we have African Americans, we have Anglos, we have Asians, we have Hispanics. Through Christ, we can show others that we have broken down the barriers between different groups by the power of Christ. That now love, friendship, understanding, cooperation, we can say we're brothers and sisters in Christ. It's a miracle. It's awesome. In the New Testament, Jews and Gentiles, before they couldn't even sit down together because the Jews thought that the Gentiles were unclean, but eventually they did sit down, have a good meal together, and they could say they were brothers and sisters in Christ. So here at First Baptist, we are people that can bring the blessing of the gospel to other people by showing that we understand this reconciliation between God and humanity was made by Jesus on the cross, and we can, by our actions, bless other people to know about that reconciliation. That's how we look at it from a experience forgiveness, and we can show others that we've broken down barriers. There are many barriers in our culture. Barriers of class and economics, which we don't feel so comfortable being together. Barriers of race. Barriers of come from perhaps different neighborhoods or different language and different histories. In Christ, we can begin to show the great miracle that we have love, friendship, understanding, cooperation, and finally say that we're brothers and sisters in Christ, hug one another, serve one another, and know that we are one in Him. That is, as young people would say, awesome. Today, our scripture, if you look at the bulletin, it says, you are a new creature in Christ. It's positive. You're being reconciled to God. When we were far away, we were brought near. We're reconciled to God. And finally, you are an ambassador for Jesus. You are an ambassador. While we're here, we're modeling that. And when we go, we can model that. It's all good news through Christ. Amen. Shall we pray? We thank you, Lord, for First Baptist Church.